Do you want to try and hit on here?
Yeah.
If you go there, I'll try and get
it. Sorry.
Almost 1 month ago that a busking band of brothers defeated the devil himself, winning his prized golden cello in a fiddling battle that would go down in history. Now you may think, why aren't these fiddlers enjoying the basking the ambience of doing such a great feat? Well, this is why. You see, there is a prophecy inscribed most delicately and minutely on the back of their golden prize. A prophecy which reads thusly.
Well, 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 looks like you won the golden cello. To whomever plays it first, you are an unfortunate fellow. There are more roadable streets, yes, but also others attached. The first to make a sound runs me in a brand new contract. You have exactly 1 month, and this figure I stress, to play a rip-roaring show and the world to impress. Failure to me, the simplest of terms, will mean that the cello is mine and your soul burns!
We join the fiddlers as they sit in desperation, 1 week before the deadline of the devil's devious contract. You see, if they fail to put on the most rip-roaring show in all the lands, their comrade, Alistair, will surely die. The moon is flattening. I bring to you the fiddlers on the ramp.
Thank you. Thank you.
sooner had our ramps captured their precious shark than be made captives themselves by bloodthirsty pirates. Immediately, the brutes threw them into the hold and told them to turn out their pockets. Of course, all that fell onto the deck was a booty worthless to such merchants of savagery. But what's this? A cello made of real gold. As the pirates begin to salivate, Alistair conjures up a brilliant plan.
Can I get this, Bill?
Oh, it's a beauty, Skip. Aye, oh.
Wait, the cello's cursed.
Oh, easy there, son, easy there. How so?
Take a look at the back.
Listen here, boy. My dad lights are tired. So, why don't you read out?
Alright,
no touching, though.
Well, well, well. Looks like you've got the golden cello. To whoever owns it, you are an unfortunate fellow. You have exactly one day, and this figure I stress, to tell a rip-roaring tale of the world to impress. Failure to meet these simplest of terms will mean the cello is mine, and your soul burns.
So you're saying we could steal this cello? But if we don't tell a rip-roaring tale, we'd lose it by tomorrow.
Yeah.
Well, here's a little plan for you. How about you tell a rip-roaring tale, lift the curse off this cello, and then we'll talk about your fate after.
Hey! I've got a tale. It's about a boy and... Malcolm.
Stick her in a hold, Skip.
On a cold and frosty morn, when Alistair and Rab awoke hungry for breakfast, only to find their cornflakes box empty on the shelf. Since Rab had done all the last night's dishes, it was Alistair's turn to make the fateful trudge to the shop. Once he got there, he scoured the cereal aisle top to bottom, and he found not a single speck of cornflake dust. But when he got to the end of the aisle, he was struck by something which made the very hair on the back of his neck stand up. The Crunchy Nut Monster. Alistair's fellow nut allergy sufferers will know that a meeting with such a monster means certain death. He bounded out of the cereal aisle, out past the checkout, and all the way back to the house, where he told Rab of his meeting with the beast. Rab said, "You must get far away from this monster. Why don't you go all the way out to Livingston? They never run out of cornflakes in Livingston, and the monster will never find you there." Once he had gone, Rab went back to the shop to give the monster a piece of his mind. He found it lurking behind some wholesome but neglected porridge oats, and he said to the beast, "How dare you scowl at my friend and threaten him with allergies of nut?" And the beast said,
"Accuse me not, dear sir, of threatening your friend, for it was a look of surprise I gave him. I have a meeting with him later on today in a shop in Livingston."
A fine tale, lads.
Oh, it's a fine tale. Oh.
Here.
I'm so
wrong.
Any nuts in this?
Oh, is it nuts for you, eh?
It's gluten for me.
Who's dishing out the rum there? Give me that, Skip. Listen, it was a nice tale. With the cello, it looked the same. I'll give you one more chance, only if you play someone a bit quicker, eh, lads?
Right, Kangaroo. Okay, now.
Thank you.
nautical tail then, is it?
Oh, aye.
Ah, they're my favorite.
Swam to the deepest depths of the ocean to meet their beloved kangaroo monster.
Intrepid folk band managed to escape with the golden cello. They used the instrument, which was of course magical, as a raft and sailed for 3 days and three nights. Until... they came to a tropical island. Discovered that it searched the whole island, but there was no sign of food or water. You see, everything was inflatable on this island, for some reason. They played a tune to cheer themselves up.
Thank you.
out, you son of a bitch, I'm the best that's ever been. Man, he plays!
Satin bittersweet reminiscence. All prospects of success seemed lost. The golden cello that had brought them so many woes still sat there in the sand, almost taunting. And then, in a moment of utter clarity, Malcolm seized the wretched instrument from hell and raised it high above his head to the heavens. You see, he was a worldly gentleman, and he knew that a castaway's best friend was shiny precious metal. He thought perhaps he could reflect the sun rays into the eyes of a passenger on a passing cruise ship. Yes, they would have plenty of food and water, and an audience who would listen to them, and maybe even buy their CD at the end. Who knows what miracles could wait ahead? He shone that chap. Wait! Something was in the sky. It was coming towards him. It was sort of brown and hairy. And then it hit. It was a coconut that flew down from the sky, taking down the golden cello, and with it, the ramp's prospects of salvation. This was the end. There would be no show.
Alistair, 1 hour until I eat your soul.
Upon hearing the final warning from the devil, the ramp set aside all thoughts of former triumphs and future glories. They had accepted their predicament. They scooped up the solitary coconut and began to prepare it. You see, Ali's soul was soon to be vanquished, but it did not need to be vanquished on the devil's terms. His nut allergy provided an alternative. They decided they would each partake in a drink from the hairy chalice, and when it got to Ali's turn, it would slowly coerce his body into anaphylactic shock, and he would thusly welcome death with open arms. So it was settled. A toast.
Thank you.
Intermission to remind you that Ramp's Fringe EPs are available at the door after the show. Get them on the fresh ball for now. There we go.
Thanks.
shanty and I'd say it loud and make it. Sobs on deck, crows, the strike the day to do. Sobs on deck, crows, the strike the day to do. Sobs on deck, crows, the smart by the door. Sobs on deck, crows, the smart by the door.
Take a stare at those, take a stare at those, by the sand. Take a stare at those, take a stare at those, by the sand.
How about you? How about him? How about her? How about Ali? off at night.
Have you really? Do you want to